Well, I want to introduce our esteemed speaker tonight, Dr. Pat Abbott. And if you know anything about geology, you know that Dr. Abbott's sort of the guy in San Diego. He literally wrote the book on San Diego geology. Dr. Abbott got his PhD from the University of Texas, where he specialized in the study of sedimentary rocks. So we may hear a little bit about that tonight. But for many, many years, Dr. Abbott was a professor at San Diego State University. And although I never had the privilege of taking a course with Dr. Abbott, his courses are absolutely legendary. And I can remember for a number of years, whenever there was an earthquake anywhere in San Diego, this is no exaggeration, but the TV stations would line up five deep to interview Dr. Abbott about the earthquake. And so I think, was it around 8 o'clock, Pat, we actually have an earthquake scheduled?
I should hope so. How else can you appreciate earthquakes?
So since we're talking about earthquakes tonight. And the other thing I just wanted to tell you quickly about Pat is he developed a course at San Diego State called Natural Disasters, which early in my career I had the privilege of teaching a couple semesters at State, that course. But it's, and I think still this is true to this day, it's the most popular course at San Diego State. Over 1,000 students take this course every semester. So if you do find yourself at San Diego State, take Geology 303, I think it is, right?
Right.
Natural Disasters. Dr. Abbott literally wrote the book. One other thing, I'll just another book plug, but if you're interested in finding out more about San Diego geology, Dr. Abbott, a number of years ago, wrote a wonderful book that I still use to this day called The Rise and Fall of San Diego with wonderful field trips. So please welcome Dr. Pat Abbott.
All right. Thank you, Don. It's great to come to a college named after a geological landform, Mesa College. You know, we don't get that privilege very often. I'm glad you have that heightened sense of appreciation here. What I wanted to do, though, I'm told this is part of the STEM series here, where we're looking at science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. And I thought maybe I'd say a few words about that first before we went into earthquakes. You know, because I can remember back when I was an undergraduate and, you know, taking science classes, and I remember that a lot of times, when working on a class like, here's a class on structural geology, folds and faults, and here's one on paleontology, you're looking at clam and snail fossils, and here's one on groundwater, you're looking at underground water. A lot of time, a lot of work, and I remember a lot of my friends saying, come on, it's time to go have fun. I've got work to do. You know, it takes more effort if you're going to be a STEM student. Then a little line I just heard, I was just back at the University of Texas here a few weeks ago, and they're talking to they hired a new coach to start a women's rowing team, which you don't really think of in the middle of Texas. But at any rate, so he has to go out and sell these young women about why you want to get up at sunrise and get out there and work so hard rowing that boat and doing it in total coordination with seven other women. A lot of hard work. And the line he uses to sell that kind of reminds me of being a STEM major. He says, it doesn't have to be fun to be fun. And the point is, when you put out that extra effort in the short term, it comes back in the long term. And just for myself right here, not that I'm unique in this, but these days, by the time I've taken those courses, like I mentioned like three very different topics, after a certain amount of time and effort, they begin to fuse into one. And all of a sudden, a fault and a clam fossil and underground water don't sound like separate topics. They fuse into, this is for geology, where you kind of get a sense of the earth, the feel for how things work. And that's a great sense of pleasure, fun to me. One more thing I'll say about that then, that even though I'm not at San Diego State anymore, I'm with Smithsonian. I lead field trips and lecture all around the world for them. I just got back from a three-weeker at Patagonia. And I don't mean this is a me thing. I'm talking about it as payback for all those years of effort, particularly the efforts put in when you're young. And before that, I just did 6 weeks in a row for them, which was Portugal to Canary Islands, Morocco, Gibraltar, Spain, Switzerland, Italy, Croatia, Montenegro, Albania, and Greece, lecturing the same things I did there. And to me, I tell people work is more fun than play. Now, I'm not knocking golf, fishing, bridge, poker, any of those kinds of things. And when I get old, maybe I'll do those. But right now, I'm still enjoying the payback from all that effort I put in as a STEM student. And I don't mean, I'm not trying to do a commercial for geology, although I'd be happy to, but it's the larger one right here of STEM, of finding a niche, finding a place where you get some satisfaction, putting out that effort, and I think it pays off in the long run. But now, we're gonna get going before that earthquake arrives. We have some background material to do here. So first, a lot of these things. Now, if you've had class from Don or Ray or others here, this may be old hat to you. But for the first thing, I always loved this when this thing came out about this map of the world and you look at earthquake epicenters. And what's an epicenter of an earthquake? That means it's someplace where one side of the earth moved past another. And the striking thing is, when you look at the pattern of earthquake epicenters, it's not random at all. It's very ordered, isn't it? And what happens then if we did this like an old connect the dots puzzle and come around here and connect the dots? What is it that we are connecting or defining? Maybe you know those things by now. The tectonic plates of the earth. And look at the next diagram, which is same focus right here. But here are those plates. So we go around those plates and we can see that these plates, there's three things they can do to each other. These things are about 60 miles thick. We always use it. You probably have heard that. They use that hard-boiled egg analogy. You know, if you take the hard-boiled egg and do that, it breaks into pieces. And you know how when you go to take them off, they kind of slide around. Well, that's the Earth, except the pieces of eggshell are about 60 miles thick. And we're interested in earthquakes tonight. So what can these plates do, these pieces? They could pull apart, they could slide past each other, or they can run into each other. So are these earthquakes the biggest or the smallest, the pull apart?
Smallest.
And the biggest are the collisional. And of course, that's where we're going to build on some of those things now. So here's just this diagram, a little bit about the plates. So here it's about 60 miles thick. And we're going to have hot rock rise up, become magma. As it builds these huge mountain ranges, gravity pull those apart. That's the seafloor spreading. That's the reason we never really understood the Earth until about 50 years ago, because they'd only looked at the rocks on the continents. And the way the Earth works is in the oceans. You form new ocean basins, those ocean basins spread apart as you show there, and the continents simply ride along as passive, low-density riders. They're exerting no force themselves, they're simply passengers. But we can't just keep expanding this, we have to have some balance of mass, and here's that subduction. So, I mean, this diagram here, if you wanted to make a real world, you could say that's March 11, 2011. That's the Japanese magnitude 9.0 earthquake. And then the other type we talked about, what's the most famous one of those in the world? Slide past fault? San Andreas fault. Everybody in the world has heard of that one. So here we get earthquakes up into magnitude 6, let's say. Here they top out maybe at magnitude 8, and here's where we get the 9s. So when they say that California is earthquake country, no, we're up here maximum possible in 8. 3 of the 50 states have had magnitude 9s, and they are second biggest earthquake ever measured. Most of the people in the room aren't going to remember this as well as I do. 1964, Alaska, 9.2. magnitude. The other two that have had a 9.0, the big three states for monster earthquakes, also Washington and Oregon. They had a 9.0 in the year 1700. It's an elegant scientific story to explain why, but I'm going to move on from that right now. So here's our plate, looking at the biggest piece of eggshell, if you will, or the biggest plate. It's the Pacific plate. Here we see it spreading apart this way. There's the subduction over there. There'd be that Japanese earthquake. And again, here's our San Andreas fault as one of the slide past boundaries. Now, for us, it's interesting to hear, you know, they always want us to predict earthquakes. And we can predict earthquakes very, very nicely. We can say that 5.5 million years ago, the Los Cabos area was over here against the state of Nayarit. We can say that in 5.5 million years, it's moved this far. For us up here, we can see that if you were at Mesa College 5.5 million years ago, you would actually be in the state of Sonora, Mexico today. So can we predict earthquakes? Yes. What is this movement accompanied by? Earthquakes after earthquake after earthquake. So I could say that we've had earthquakes here in California for 5.5 million years, and I can predict that we will definitely have them for at least 1 million years more. And that's about all the prediction you're going to get, so you got to prepare on that basis. Now, I do want to mention one other thing here, because this is an old map. By old, I mean pre-GPS. And when you look here and you see numbers, like over here, I'll show them this spreading center here. See this 8? That 8 means movement of 8 centimeters a year. So that's what, over 3 inches a year of movement? And how do we know that? We know that from the magnetic patterns frozen or solidified within the rock. And if we come on up here to where we are with the movements up here, see the tip of the arrow pointing at that 5.6? That would be 5.6 centimeters per year, which would be what, over 2 inches, 2.25 inches, roughly speaking? That's the amount the San Andreas Fault should move. Does it move 2.25 inches every year? So what's the problem? That much energy is fed in, but it's stored as strain energy. It's stored and stored and stored and builds up until we release it in the big earthquakes that we're famous for. Now, this is very, very impressive. Now, I don't mean this to be rude, but I've got to, well, this is geology, so I have to defend my home court here. With the advent of GPS coming in to be able to measure land movements and so forth, so here's all these numbers that we have on the map showing what the movements are in centimeters per year. How did GPS change our understanding? Zero, zip, nada, nothing. Now, that's great, because in science, what you want? You want verification of things, so it's nice to have things verified. I'm not trying to make fun of GPS, but I'm trying to say it basically showed us that what we had from the paleomagnetism and the rocks was right. And so we really do understand how things are moving over longer time spans. But we do not have that thing that people want, like the weather report. Well, I guess we did say that. What, 8 p.m. tonight we have an earthquake? Right. Well, okay. Well, occasional exception, but usually we simply say sometimes in the next 100 years or so. Oh, I'm sorry. I had to put this up. This is actually, isn't that the kind of thing you'd like to frame and hang on your wall? Wait a minute. I was expecting a chorus of yeses there, but okay. So here's the California border with Baja California, and so here's Catalina Island or Santa Barbara up here. So these colored bands, this isn't just artwork. These are the faults. So these are the actual faults. This is not science. Not artistic creation. It's science. So what you're seeing here, one thing is the faults are what? They're 10 to 12 miles deep. And that's where the rocks are the most brittle. Once things get warmer, they're going to tend to deform more. And of course, what we're most concerned with, that we live with, are the one part that's brittle and snaps. That's where we really get hit with the energy. And what you're seeing here, but these different color patterns, those are specific past movements of individual earthquakes. So you kind of get a feel for all of that. And then you see a lot of the other little aftershock sequences and so forth. So what do we see here? We see here's the San Andreas coming up here, the big San Andreas. Then we see San Jacinto, Elsinore. Here's our Rose Canyon, Newport, Inglewood. Well, anyway, you see the faults of Southern California. So we have a heck of a lot of them. Now, in terms of talking about earthquakes, one of the bottom line messages is it's not the earthquakes are the problem. If we really knew when an earthquake was going to happen, when we knew if that San Andreas was going to move, seriously, I'd call Don, and I'm not joking. We would organize a field trip to take as many people as possible out to the desert. And if we're out there on the desert floor, relatively near the San Andreas Fault, and it goes into magnitude 8, what happens to us? Fall down, bounce around on the sand a little bit. You're not going to have injuries even as big as Ray Rector has when he falls off his skateboard from time to time. So it would be a great, great event. The point simply being, it's not the earthquakes that are the problem. What's the problem? It's our buildings. We build things and they fall on us, and there's our trouble. And I like to just compare this I don't mean to be rude or insensitive here, but as an instructive sort of a thing, I call these earthquakes, well, this would be the World Series earthquake in October 1989 up in the San Francisco Bay Area. And here's that horrific one that happened in Haiti in January of 2010. And you look at them, magnitudes are the same, strike slip faults, that means the horizontal motion kind of a fault, near a major city, wooden steel buildings, 60 dead, masonry buildings, almost 250,000 dead. Same earthquake, what's the difference? Buildings. So one thing I am proud of Californians for, I won't go through all the details, but major earthquakes we've had like 1933, 1971, 1989, 1994. Every year after a major earthquake in California, the legislature will pass a law, building codes will change to try to not repeat the same mistake again. In other words, we have these fatal, brutal experiences, learn from them. Californians have done the job, and I'm proud of them for that, and we're still working, of course, to get that to zero. Now, what I wanted to do here is talk a little bit more about, near field, far field, but what really is, Don wrote on the title of the thing here, Rose Canyon Fault versus San Andreas Fault, different buildings are going to shake differently depending on which fault it is that moves. Let's look at far field first. Let's say here, this is the 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake here, the so-called World Series earthquake. The purple patch there is the part of the fault that moved. And you can see we're very near the city of Santa Cruz here, and we're a long ways from Oakland. And that's what I mean by near field or far field. Santa Cruz is right there. That would be like San Diego with the Rose Canyon Fault running through here. Oakland's a far away. That would be like the San Andreas Fault moving out there in the desert, and here we are in San Diego. So let's look at far field. There's near field, there's far field. So the most horrific event that happened up there was in Oakland when the Interstate 880 freeway bridges collapsed and, of course, caught those cars in between there. So what was the structure here? It's tall structure sitting on San Francisco Bay mud. So these are the kinds of things. What are the buildings here in that particular case? Tall, heavy structure. Once it gets moving and gets its own momentum, that's a very prone to collapse, particularly if it's on a bad foundation. Now, looking at the San Andreas a little bit in terms of history, here is the 1906 San Francisco earthquake. Do you imagine that? That ruptured the ground surface for 260 miles. The World Series earthquake, the Northridge earthquake, neither of them even broke the ground surface. And yet, today when we try to estimate that, we come out with, and by estimating I mean you look at how far the earth was ruptured, what the maximum movements were, it's estimated that was a 7.8 magnitude, which is quite small. You'll still say people seeing it in the eights and things like that. Here's a zone here where, the rock's serpentine, it's a real slippery kind of a rock. So with real slippery rocks in here, how do you build up stress? You know, you don't. You have lots of little earthquakes rather than a few big ones. Here's 1857. This was called the Fort Tejon earthquake. 1857, California population doesn't really take off to what? The Gold Rush, which is 1849. And of course, that's up here, not down there. And then, so where do we estimate for our part of the San Andreas? About the year 1690. And we do that off of measuring, we're not going to go into it in detail here, but you dig trenches. My colleague Tom Rockwell out of San Diego State, they dig trenches, they measure the offset of a rock layer, you use radiocarbon dates to figure out roughly when things moved, and the relationship's relatively obvious. The bigger the physical movement, the more energy released, the bigger the earthquake. So this isn't science, but if you looked at it and you said 1906, 1857, 1690, which one do you expect next? And what you'll see here when they do the statistics, this is supposed to be next. Does that mean it will be?
No.
Could both of these move again before this one? Yeah, we try to simplify to understand Mother Nature, but we don't. It's their rule of thumb kinds of things. So here's our scenario earthquake now, agreed on by a whole group of people as for something to plan for. And you probably have seen this. It's been several years now. So here's the Salton Sea. Here's Mesa College here. And so what we see, the San Andreas Fault, let's assume that it moves through that zone up here past Palm Springs, through the San Bernardino city limits up to Cajon Pass, that area. That would be about a magnitude 7.8 earthquake. So what would we feel here in San Diego? Well, here's a simulation from this. This is by Kim Olson out at San Diego State. And so this is, again, what they've tried to do is put into the computer the knowledge about rock bodies, the rock strengths, tried to with this, you see this tera shake. So these are terabytes of data, not approximations, trying to put in as much data as possible to see what would we have. And so what we see here is under the assumed rupture of south to north, well, pretty intense. The more intense shaking here, soft sediments. The lesser shaking, harder rock. We're not talking about the buildings now, just the ground. Not as much this way. Does that make sense? If the earthquake is here and it's going this way towards you, how much energy are you feeling versus somebody behind? Or put it this way, you're here and the earth ruptures going away from you. There's a directional aspect to that energy. So when we assume for this model, we make it go to the north, could it just as easily go from north to south? That's what the 1857 one did. Could it break in the middle and go north and south simultaneously? That's what the Loma Prieta earthquake did. So when we're doing these simulations and all, we're not stating exactly how something's going to happen. So here we are for San Diego. A minute and 33 seconds later, look at these things that have come through, more on their way, not as bad as here, but the way I usually like to describe that, were you here for that earthquake on Easter 6 years ago? Did you feel that? I loved that earthquake because it was so cool, because with very little damage, or not real harm, I think it let San Diegans see what the big time is like. You know, San Diegans, what's an earthquake? 4 or 5 seconds of shaking, oh, big deal, who cares? But that was the big time, right? Depending on what you're on, you're feeling that, go 30 seconds, 40 seconds, 50 seconds. That's the taste of the big time. Now, let's take, this is rule of thumb now. Let's just take this same thing here. Well, look here. We're at 93 seconds and we're not over. We're already more than twice as long. So make the movements that you felt, make them twice as high. Hopefully nothing major fails in San Diego, but earthquakes are the test. And that's what we usually do with an earthquake. It's usually not widespread destruction. 1971, it was the Veterans Hospital in San Fernando that fell. In 1989, we already saw the picture. It was the elevated I-880 roadway that collapsed. So you don't know where the bad ones are going to be, but unfortunately, there commonly are one or more. So here's what, building designs. Here's the problem. If we take this circular motion and say, do they build buildings to design them for a horizontal movement? An upward movement, another horizontal movement, a downward movement? What do we usually do? We build the building, we know gravity's pulling it down. How do we design for the horizontal push? And so I've taken the circle and I've just broken it into vectors. If we're going to do this engineering style, put force vectors, you know, we have to make a building stand up to these kinds of forces. And this one right here is a classic one, because a vertical upright versus a heavy horizontal bed, are they going to shake the same? This one's doing this and that one's doing something. And so that's one of the basic problems. I'm trying to take down to horizontal pushes as a problem. And then I'm also trying to say that connecting verticals to horizontals becomes critical. Whether it's your house or a freeway bridge, you're trying to, well, what are we trying to do? We're trying to make buildings stand up. We have to tie the pieces together. Now, here's the two pictures. Here are the thing. I love retrofitting. I love putting in more money to begin with, rather than afterwards nobody talks about the billions of dollars you spend to clean it up. Why not put more in to begin with? So here is 1994 Northridge earthquake. Here's I-605 going over I-5. And you see here the blending of two materials. Here's steel rebar. And we like steel because it's ductile. It has an ability to give. And here's concrete, which we like because it's strong. And so what you try to do is you take this strong, brittle concrete, put it around the steel. You're trying to marry the two. You want to get the ductility of the steel and the strength of the concrete and have the two complement each other? Well, that's a failure. The bridge didn't come down. It's an engineering failure, even though it wasn't a failure for people. Now what? Look at this. See the horizontal rebar wrapping it together? Look over here under the new way. See how many horizontal wraps there are around it? Now here comes the concrete. We're already better than we were, but we're not quit. Now put in big steel casing around that, bolt that together, bolting one of these together with this steel, and now cover that with concrete. So instead of a double layer, we'll do a quadruple layer and then do each layer stronger. In other words, let's not have bridges keep falling down. Anybody ever go on the 805 bridge coming to Mesa College? They did some retrofitting on that, and I already said I'm a big fan, but this is what, a tall structure sitting on a base, and what's the foundation here, hard rock? It's loose San Diego River sand with water in it. So I'm not predicting. I used to predict disaster for this until they retrofitted it, so now I'm not going to predict disaster anymore. I do ask your forgiveness for the fact that I step on my accelerator when I go across there. But what I am saying, these are the kinds of structures that will suffer the most severe shaking from the San Andreas. I'm saying we'll suffer the most shaking. I'm not saying they're going to collapse, but I'm just saying ones that you have to have extra care for. So here's this liquefaction. Here we are up at Monterey, and you just simply see the water-saturated sand doesn't stay as a very firm foundation. It literally liquefies, as you see there. But that's the foundation of buildings. This is one of my favorites. this Japanese one here. They're built on water-saturated sands. And you see how some of these apartment buildings fell over? What's the death toll here? High? Medium? None? Actually none. So here's the instructive part. Remember when we're talking about those seismic waves going in a circle like this? So when it goes like this, here's sand grains sitting together with water in between them. When the seismic wave comes in and lifts it apart, what's the foundation then momentarily? It's water. The water is between the grains. Then it comes back in contact again. Then it's lifted apart. Then it comes back in contact again. Why aren't the people dead? Because it didn't go like this. It went down like that. And then, so what was the evacuation here? You walk out your fourth floor window, walk down the sign. So well-built buildings on a bad foundation. And so that, literally speaking, they jack those things back up and they're occupied again. Now you do some more things to the foundation that you didn't do before, but see, the buildings were built well, but it illustrates liquefaction anyway. So, Rose Canyon Fault in San Diego, we'll look at that. It breaks into strands, they go underneath this Coronado Bridge here, but again, we've done retrofitting there. I've already said I'm a fan of retrofitting. This is the Islandia Hotel in Mission Bay. Landers earthquake in 1992, Mojave Desert moving north. The Islandia Hotel had some of these claddings fall. Nobody got hurt. But if the direction had been coming the other way, I don't stay in that hotel, but. Just big office buildings in Mission Valley. Again, they're on water-saturated sand. I'm just saying the ones that get the biggest tests. I'm not predicting any disasters here. I don't know enough to know. When I ask building owners or structural engineers, you know what kind of response I get? They're not things that anybody wants to talk about. These on the southern part of Coronado, they're going on to the Silver Strand. These buildings right here are what? 60, 70 years old? They're way back several earthquake codes. That's one there that I would be I don't live there either, but. I think the next one's one of my favorites. So the SeaWorld Tower, the little thing, observation deck that goes up. So you're sitting on water. Well, here's the water, and you're on the sand. when you go up to the top, if the observation deck goes up there with 25 people in it, that's a heavy weight. So what does that do? Here, let's say that the thing's down at the bottom, how does it shake? By the time you get it up here loaded with people, does it shake more, the same, or less?
More.
You have more mass up there. So I, this is one I literally do when I have out-of-town people that want to go to SeaWorld. I say, oh, no, go right ahead. I've done that so many times. I'll wait for you down here on the ground. I says, how can I enjoy it when, you know? Don tells me we're having an earthquake tonight at 8 p.m. How do I know the point of one of these things is going to come? I don't want to be up there. Okay, now let's look at that closer. So here's the P-Wave movie. The Slinky toy, it's one of these things that still pleases me when I go to a room full of, you know, 18-year-olds or whatever. I say, Slinky toy, anybody know what that toy is? It seems to be, yes, it seems to go on through time. I'm so pleased. But particularly because that's what a P-Wave is doing. You know, when you see the Slinky toy, what happens? A whole bunch of little metal coils are together, and then they pull apart. They're together and pull apart. And see, that's exactly what the P-Wave's doing. Now, put a building on top up here. Is this a real bad thing? No. The ground's not really doing that much. This isn't that bad. What is bad is this is the P-Wave, meaning it's the primary wave. It's the fastest of the waves. It's the one that gets here first. But the second wave, the secondary wave, now put that building up here. Have you heard about we have an earthquake warning system? Not prediction, but warning. If a big earthquake broke out in Long Beach, we would have the P waves come in like this, and then the S waves are slower. They're coming along after that. So you can get seconds of warning before the really destructive waves get here. What do you get if you're at the epicenter? Warnings. Everything's there. P waves, S waves, Rayleigh waves, Love waves, they're all, you know, it's like the rock hitting the water. You got everything there. The farther away you are, the more warning time you get. Bad news is usually the farther away you are, the less problem there is, but not always. Remember Mexico? Well, no. In September 1985, way before you were born, Mexico City had over 9,000 people killed in an earthquake that occurred, the fault movement occurred 200 miles away. Building types sitting on lake muds. Same kind of principles. Okay, so let's get over here to San Diego, or we'll look at it first up in the, we're back now at city of Santa Cruz now. So here's where the San Andreas Fault moves. Here's the city of Santa Cruz. And what I wanted to show is like this picture. Here's their Pacific Garden Mall. These are old brick buildings, one and two story brick buildings. And it seems like every city does this now, right? You take the old historic districts and you save them because they are historic buildings. I like that. And then they make them into restaurants and things of that sort. Are they earthquake proof? No. If you make them earthquake proof, a lot of times that's going to cost more money than tearing them down and building new ones. I'm taking no sides here. I'm merely talking about a predicament that lots of cities have faced and will continue to face. Do you honor, you're going to honor your history and run the earthquake risk, or are you going to tear down something that's hazardous and rebuild it? In Santa Cruz, they decided they'd go with, oh, earthquakes don't happen that often. Well, theirs came down. And what do we call? They call it Pacific Garden Mall. What do we call the same thing in San Diego?
Old time market. Rose cranes.
I was thinking gas lamp district.
Oh. I was going to say no.
Well, I was referring to the buildings. Yeah, you're right in terms of the land. I was thinking buildings.
Oh, right.
So here's one of the things that's these kinds of bricks have been illegal since the 1933 earthquake. You know those reddish kind of clay pots you put plants in? You know how easy those break and fracture? That's what these do. They fracture very, very easily. I'll show you another picture about sizes here. But they're corrugated, so they have the plaster goes over them very nicely. So let's look at another picture where here's a building downtown, and it may have been rented by now, so don't rush down there. But here's regular bricks that you think of, solid bricks. And here are these hollow core ones. And I find sometimes if I happen to be downtown, like in that gas lamp district, and I'll go walking along, and they do such beautiful jobs with colors now. You know, this might be Something might be painted light gray here, but here's a bit of black accent here, and then some gold leaf colors right there, and you walk by, and it looks so cool. And I go walking by, and I look to see, here's where a delivery truck backed in and went right through that brick. It's hollow inside. It's illegal. It's been illegal since 1933. That building's coming down in an earthquake, and you can't necessarily see them or recognize them. And again, I'm just describing what is. I'm not pointing fingers, because they're very complex problems. Now, what do we basically do? We basically assume that earthquakes don't come often, and buildings have a lifespan, and we hope that the building outlives its lifespan and is replaced. Now, in that sense, here's a positive one. The one element only, I'm not discussing everything about it, the baseball park, Petco Field. Well, when they built that they knocked down all kinds of buildings that would have fallen down in an earthquake. So those were removed and replaced with a massive steel frame structure that can handle an earthquake. So as a society, it's always the easiest thing to do is wait and let things happen on their own. And there we are there. Now, I love these shots, this imagery we get. So, I mean, here's Mesa College right here. And here's Los Angeles, here we're up to Santa Barbara, and we look at the offshore. Can you see the faults? Do you see like knife gashes in the seafloor? See those faults? Like, just look at those faults jump out at you. Look at these faults. Now, every one of these islands is there because they're lifted up by faults. They don't usually talk about those ones because you can't go see them so easily, you just see the islands. And one of these ones I want to call to your attention, do you see this line of hills here? Mentally do this, just to the right of this, Interstate 405, if you're driving along here, whether there's Signal Hill, Rosecrans Hill, Dominguez Hills, all those hills, they're all squeezed up along the Newport-Inglewood Fault. Then in 1933, that's the second deadliest earthquake in California history, the Long Beach earthquake, 120 people killed. That fault, if we come down here, is the exact same fault that goes through San Diego, that's the Rose Canyon fault, same fault. So that's what happened in 1933. Well, it hadn't happened here since Europeans moved in here in the late 1700s. So that we can easily expect that. And part of me is saying don't say this, and part of me says do say it, but did you hear the news the last couple of weeks where they were talking about the Newport-Inglewood Fault, the new discovery, the Newport-Inglewood Fault, the Rose Canyon Fault are the same? I was leading a trip around Patagonia, which got me out of it, but I even got a call from, of all things, the Bill O'Reilly Show. I didn't know they even discussed things like nature on there, and I didn't do any of them because these slides, I've been doing this lecture, sometimes people say, don't you get tired of saying the same old thing all the time? And I always say Rose Canyon Fault, same thing as Newport-Inglewood Fault. I've been saying that, and I don't mean me. It's been proven for over 30 years that they're the same. Proven, not a hypothesis, proven. And then it goes nationwide that here's this brand new discovery. Maybe the people who did the work didn't say that. That may have been the media, but somehow, who knows? Why does something take off all of a sudden and other ones don't? But anyway, I don't know whether I should say those things or not. But the other thing they were talking about, at least that I heard it from the news, and I'm in Chile, so I'm not hearing all the details you are. They talk about how see how this don't match exactly? So what these really are, they're more like these kinds of things. We call them on echelon, where it splits into patterns like this. And they were talking about how that they discovered that the earthquake could move on one of these faults over to the next strand and keep moving. Well, that's, remember the Landers earthquake? June of 1992? One of my favorite earthquakes. What I like in earthquakes is not death and destruction. I like ones where I learn something. And I mean you're welcome too. Everybody is here. So the earthquake starts here, moves up this fault, and a lot of people have felt and written and said for years that it would die right there. The energy wouldn't carry over to the next fault, but it did. And it went all the way up to the end of this one. Then it moved over and went all the way up to the end of a third fault. Then it moved over and started a fourth fault going, and the movement stopped in the middle of the fourth fault, violating all the expectations. Well, then this same little study in the news here in the last couple of weeks, they just discovered this phenomenon here. According to that news, they just discovered what I've had in 10 editions of a textbook, but I shouldn't bring it up because I don't want politics. I want understanding the earth. And some of the things that they say are new aren't. And it's what really it matters is understanding how the earth works. Okay, so here's San Diego. And this is a real crude. I'm not very good with computer art. But here's the Rose Canyon Fault. It more or less ends right here in San Diego Bay. So this side moves this way, and when it runs into this bend, and you can make this be La Jolla Parkway, or it used to be called Ardeth Road. So remember, this when I draw a fault, remember, it's going miles deep. So if this side here pushes against that bend in the fault, what does the land surface do?
Crack.
What do we call that? Mount Soledad. That's Mount Soledad. And remember what do we have up there, the Newport Inglewood Fault, along 405? Signal Hill, Dubingas Hill, all those. So here's the same kind of action all along that fault. And so that pushes Mount Soledad up. The warping causes the land to downbend. That fills with the water. It's Mission Bay. Warps again. We call that Point Loma. So what are we doing here? If you're running one side of the earth against a miles-deep barrier, what's it do? It buckles up. Down, up, just like squishing I usually like to take a piece of paper and squeeze it to put that together. So if this is the end of the Rose Canyon Fault here, here's the next fault. It goes offshore, heads down to south of Ensenada. Have you been out there at Punta Banda on south of Ensenada, where the land sticks way out there? This fault goes all the way down to south of Ensenada where it comes back on land. So between the two faults, this fault's going this way, that one's going that way. So if these two, this fault, Rose Canyon Fault's going this way, this one's going that way, what happens in here? Pull it apart, drops down. So in a simple sense, I could say San Diego Bay, but let me tell you something more stunning. You've been out here to Cabrillo National Monument? Those sandstones and all that are out there? Well, those sandstones, they're Cretaceous age, they're about 75 million years old. When they were drilling for oil over here in the 1950s, hoping to hit things, when they're down 1 mile deep, they hit these sandstones. So when you pull it apart, you don't get to feel how deep it is, because what happens once you have a hole? Rivers run into it, bring in the sand and mud, and start filling things up. So for San Diego, the whole coastal topography, Mount Soledad, Mission Bay, Point Loma, North Island, Coronado Island, the bay itself, all of that is due to active faulting. The landscape screams active faulting. If it wasn't active faulting, erosion would smooth it all out. So there's a little bit fancier map. Well, I'll just back to houses here again. This is a common problem with buildings. We talked already about horizontal elements and vertical. One of the problems with buildings are, isn't it nice having a garage and all kinds of storage space? But then there's an engineering term for this. I like terms that aren't fancy. How about soft first story? No, that's because it's soft because when you think about your house or the apartment where you live, in general what happens? You walk in an entryway and here's a wall separating you from the living room, another wall, there's the kitchen, another wall, there's the bedroom. What does that do to the earthquake stability of a home? As a home is moved, there are walls in all kinds of directions going from the ceiling to the floor, providing internal support. Take away the walls like a garage, now we're back to like the freeway bridge. What's holding up the house? This one thin wall here, that one wall there, soft for a story, down it comes. So, you know, the very simple things, I tell this to a lot of people, when they ask me about should you buy earthquake insurance, and I always say, you know, there's a big deductible on those. If you're on a bad foundation like we've been looking at, get earthquake insurance. But if you don't, what does it take to make a building stand together well? Bolts going into the foundation, angle iron here, tying the vertical to the horizontal, you know, blocking, putting other pieces of wood in here, putting diagonals in there, covering it with plywood or sheetrock of some sort. And if you just start tying it together with a lot of things which are pretty cheap, then it's now in good shape to stand up to an earthquake. hopefully your house, the newer the houses are, the more of that kind of thing they have in it. But most of the problems we've had are with the complex buildings, not the homes. In general, homes are much better. The biggest kinds of problem homes that still remain are the ones, in the old days, if the land sloped a little bit, they would build a floor and they'd have a little short wall holding it up, a cripple wall, you could crawl underneath there. That's one source of problems. And then again, it just, it's a little bit newer to putting more braces in it, a little bit more to try to tie the house to the foundation. So a lot of those things, that the codes have gone up on those. But for the most part, the big problems are with the big fancy structures, not homes. Well, here's a factoid for you. Here's the house as built, you move into it. 1994 Northridge earthquake, 10% of the deaths occurred inside people's homes when their own belongings fell on them or were thrown at them. And you're 100% on your own right there. So, you know, when you go to bed tonight, if you look up there and you see a ceiling fan, I would take it down or move the bed, one or the other. You know, I mean, just think about what could possibly fall. And so here's another type of structure I was talking about. They call these tilt-ups, where you lay this down on the ground and pour the concrete where it's real cheap and easy to do. Then you tilt them up. And so, of course, now the problem is how do you tie them together? I bring this up because these have been particularly bad performing kinds of buildings. I'm just trying to show there where it's still tilted up. See where all the little supports holding it up temporarily till they, quote, tie it together. So buildings like that in San Diego? Don't let me spoil your concert enjoyment here, but all right. Now, here's one I like. Oh, you're on Highway 163, you're going through Balboa Park, and you come out there, and right, you know, you got your choice. You're going to go into I-5 or Ash or A, those things. Yeah. Look at this building right here. Look what they did now. Oh, here, I even wrote it, 10th and A. Look what they did here. Look in so it looks like design. They incorporated it into the structure, the ability to stand up to earthquakes. And where they opened this up to have more of a fancy entryway, they put thicker X's in here, thicker, more beams in there. So they built a design which at first glance looks just like design, but that's pure engineering. That's great seismic engineering. That's building buildings the way they ought to be built. Oh, I don't know what else I put in here. I never know how long I'm going to talk since I don't know what I'm going to say, but I guess I'm a little bit. But I love this thing we've been doing this last 8 years here, this great shakeout thing where drop, cover, hold on. Some of you have done that in junior high school or high school now. So our thought on that was if kids in school did that once a year, kindergarten through grade 12, you know, each year, each 13 times, that it would be in muscle memory instead of the thing, the earth is shaking. People, so many, it's an instinctive to run. Yeah. Run where? Where are you going? And a lot of, I can go through the, that Easter earthquake we had. That was one of the fatalities. There was only two fatalities. One of them was a guy, he'd come running right out of his house, running right out in the street and got whacked by a car. So if he'd have just sat in his house, he would have been fine. So that's why we say, drop, cover, hold on. What's the problem? The 10% of the deaths, Northridge earthquake, inside the house. Get underneath that table, get underneath that desk, wait the seconds till it stops, then come out. And I forget what else. And I don't even know what else is on now. I don't know if I should push the button and take responsibility for it or not.
Keep going.
Oh, okay. See this car? For scale, philosophy about how to build buildings. Here's a Japanese structure. They used to debate, build it so big and strong an earthquake can't knock it down, or do you roll with the punches? Look at the thickness of that steel rebar. Look at the diameter of this column holding up a roadbed compared to that car. We never built anything that thick, and you can see that it failed. So in other words, that helps swing the tide to don't try to build it so strong an earthquake can't knock it down. What's the better one? And here's another engineering term I like. Base isolation. Isolate the base of the building from the ground. Now this is did I write it on here? No, I didn't. San Diego County, their office complex there off of Claremont Mesa Boulevard, Ruffin Road, right in that area there. So this is the Office of Disaster Preparedness. Now they call it OES, Office of Emergency Services. So here's the building, and effectively, see what it's sitting on? See, here's something lead, lead is a metal that deforms easily, and there's little rubber things in here. So it's kind of like the shock absorbers on your car. So if the ground moves, a lot of that movement's taken up in the shock absorber rather than transferring it to the building. So that's the concept. There's a lot of different ways they've been built out now. And in an engineering sense, well, we'll have to see how the various designs perform in the next big earthquake. Oh, that's just commercial stuff. Okay, so I'll quit there then. All right, thank you very much. And if there's any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer them.